Welcome to worship at Zion this morning. As we gather, a lot of things happening in our little world here. We celebrate the gift of new life in holy baptism. In a few moments, we'll ask the family to come forward. Also, we celebrate the gift of new life for those who have passed from this life. I have been in touch with the family of Leland Randall over the last week or so. He passed away on Friday, and Leland has lived in the Twin Cities for quite some years now. His funeral will be held on Wednesday in Minneapolis at the Norwegian Mindekirken Memorial Church, Minneapolis, but there will be a graveside service here in Woodville on Thursday at 11 o'clock, and that graveside service is at Sunset Memorial Cemetery. So please keep the family of Leland Randall in your thoughts and prayers, and everyone is welcome to join them for that service on Thursday at Sunset at 11 o'clock. And there will be a fellowship time here at Zion following that memorial or that graveside service. Notes about flowers. Okay, beautiful sunflowers on the altar in honor of Karen's baptism today. And the flowers, the stargazer lilies or whatever brand of lilies they are, Ruth Hard brought those in this morning in honor of her grandson, Hunter, who is entering the Marine Corps. He left on Monday and will be with the Marines for the next 5 years. I got to know Hunter as a 12-year-old boy in Boy Scouts, and a great young man. So please remember Hunter in your prayers as he serves his country and serves us in all that he does. Also, a note, the quilters will be meeting 1 week earlier. So their quilting day is this week on Thursday. So if you are one of the quilters or are not and want to join them, this Thursday is the time to be a part of that mix. Also, we are excited about the new Sunday school year. Time flies, and we are looking for people who are willing to teach or be a guide for our kids for the Sunday school year. So give it some prayerful thought, and some of you will have to say yes. I mean, that's just the way it goes, right? So you can't all get away with saying, oh, we'll let somebody else do it. How generous you are to let someone else do that. You realize I'm just ribbing you a little bit, right? But the work will get done, and it is an exciting time, and we love Sunday school, and we love our kids, so we're looking forward to that time together. We continue our worship now as we sing our opening hymn, number 732. The hymn is Morning Cry, and I ask you to stand as you are able as we sing this hymn. We continue in the front portion of our hymnal on page 70. And as we do, I want to extend a welcome and a thank you to Andy Holman. Andy drove all the way from Norway this morning just to be our organist. Some biographical information is in the bulletin, but we are grateful that you're here. Glad to have you back home. Andy's got roots right here, so we are blessed. We continue with the Thanksgiving at the font, and we pray. Blessed are you, O God, maker and ruler of all things. Your voice thundered over the waters of creation. You water the mountains and send springs into the valleys to refresh and satisfy all living things. Through the waters of the flood, you carried those in the ark to safety. Through the sea, you led your people Israel from slavery to freedom. In the wilderness, you nourished them with water from the rock, and you brought them across the River Jordan to the promised land. By the baptism of his death and resurrection, your son Jesus has carried us to safety and freedom. The floods shall not overwhelm us, and the deep shall not swallow us up. For Christ has brought us over to the land of promise. He sends us to make disciples, baptizing in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Pour out your Holy Spirit. Wash away sin in this cleansing water. Clothe the baptized with Christ and claim your daughters and sons, no longer slave and free, no longer male and female, but one with all the baptized in Christ Jesus, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. At this time, you may be seated, and we invite Karen and her family and sponsors to join me at the font. God, who is rich in mercy and love, gives us a new birth into a living hope through the sacrament of holy baptism. By water and the word, God delivers us from sin and death and raises us to a new life in Jesus Christ. We are united with all the baptized in the one body of Christ, anointed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, and joined in God's mission for the life of the world. As we gather at the font today, I ask you, do you present Karen Marianne Balfany to receive this sacrament of holy baptism? If so, say, I do. As you bring this child to receive this gift of holy baptism, you are entrusted with these responsibilities: to live with her among God's faithful people, to bring her to the Word of God and the Holy Supper, to teach her the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments, and place in her hands the Holy Scriptures, and nurture her in faith and prayer so that she may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others and the world God made, and to work for justice and peace. Do you promise to help her grow in the Christian faith and life? If so, say, I do. And family and friends, as we gather at the font, do you promise to support Karen and pray for her in her new life in Christ? If so, say, we do. We do. And together we confess our faith in God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Karen, you ready for the water? You are right here. I will be very careful. Karen Marianne Balfany, you are baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, we do this, and then I tickle your nose just. And will you take that, please? Thank you. Karen, child of God, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Amen. Karen, you belong to Christ now, in whom you have been baptized, and we say, Alleluia. We light the baptism candle. It says, you are baptized in Christ, and there's the water. See that? We light it from this candle. We call that the Christ candle. It's a symbol that the new life we have is in Jesus. And Lily, would you please hold the candle as we pray? Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will have the light of life. And we pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit you give your daughters and sons new birth. Cleanse us from sin and raise us to eternal life. We ask that you would sustain Karen with this gift of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, and the Spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. Please join in the congregation's response as we welcome our newest sister in the faith. Karen, we welcome you into the body of Christ and into the mission we share. Join us in giving thanks and praise to God and bearing God's creative and redeeming word to all the world. Amen. And everyone, would you please welcome your newest sister in the faith? This is Karen. Let's give her a hand. It is for you, sweetheart. You did a great job. Yeah, and you can put out the candle if you'd like. And a few gifts. We give Karen her own Bible. This is yours, and it's got great pictures on every page. You can take that, but who's going to read Karen a Bible story today? Oh, you will? Good. Thank you very much. And you can't read yet? Well, maybe you can follow along. Will you take these here? I want you to come off of the chair. And I know you were just sitting there for just a little while, but you hold on to those and you. Okay, I'll show you. Not much, but let me show you something else. This is where the candle goes, and this gift, this was in that box, and it's got Karen's name and date of baptism on the back, so you'll remember that. And this is something that your grandpa made for you with the Joseph Square Group. So, yeah, it is. Here, so I'll let you take these parts, and you may be seated. One more. Yep, here. Get the letters. Good job. And we continue as we offer the prayer of the day that is printed in the worship folder. Let us pray. Beloved and sovereign God, through the death and resurrection of your Son, you bring us into your kingdom of justice and mercy. By your Spirit, give us your wisdom that we may treasure the life that comes from Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Our first reading is from 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 5 through 12. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon during the night in a dream, and God said, "Ask for whatever you want me to give you." Solomon answered, "You have shown great kindness to your servant, my father David, because he was faithful to you and righteous and upright in heart. You have continued this great kindness to him and have given him a son to sit on his throne this very day. Now, Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David, but I am only a little child and do not know how to carry out my duties. Your servant is here among the people you have chosen, a great people, too numerous to count or number. So give your servant a discerning heart to govern your people and to distinguish between right and wrong, and for who is able to govern this great people of yours." The Lord was pleased that Solomon had asked for this. So God said to him, "Since you have asked for this and do not long for life or wealth for yourself, nor have asked for the death of your enemies, but for discernment in administering justice, I will do what you have asked. I will give you a wise and discerning heart so that there never will have been anyone like you, nor will there ever be." The second lesson is from Romans 8, verse 31 through 39. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his son, but gave him up for all of us, he will not also along with him graciously give us all these things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then can condemn? No one. Jesus Christ, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger of sword? As it is written, "For your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered." No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels or demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Jesus Christ our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you, Andy. The English translation is there. The last song for the postlude that Andy is playing, the translation of that is the old woman with the staff. Is that so? I'm picturing a shepherd woman with a staff. That's what I'm picturing in my mind. Would you please rise as we hear the reading of the gospel? This is the word of God according to St. Matthew from the 13th chapter. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, which a man took and planted in his field. Though it is the smallest of all seeds, yet when it grows, it is the largest of garden plants and becomes a tree, so that the birds come and perch in its branches. He told them still another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed into about 60 pounds of flour until it worked all through the dough. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all he had and bought that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. And we take a moment to pray. Gracious God, in these little parables, you tell us what the kingdom of heaven is like. It is among us. Your word is among us, and you strive to live among your people. May we open our hearts and our minds to you, that you would show us the way, that you would give us all that, that you would show us that you give us all that we need for this life, and that you do lead us into the life that for us is yet to come in your eternal glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, today we heard a brief story in the first reading from 1 Kings chapter 3 about the young King Solomon. When his father, the great King David, was on his deathbed, these were David's parting words to his son. From 1 Kings chapter 2, King David said, "I am about to go the way of all the earth. Be strong now and show yourself a man and keep the charge of the Lord your God, walking in his ways and keeping his commandments." That's what the great King David said to his young son, who was about to take the throne. Then David died, and after the death of his father, young Solomon goes to a quiet place so that he could pray. And in a dream at that quiet place, God told Solomon to ask for anything, anything in the world. Now, that should be quite the temptation for a young man, wouldn't you think? God tells you that the sky is not even the limit. If God were to say that to you, what would you ask for? Ask for anything you want. Anything you want. Well, after Solomon made his request to God, God seemed somewhat surprised that Solomon did not ask for things like a long and healthy life, could have asked for it, all the riches in the world, could have asked for it, or in that war-torn world, still war-torn world, the death of all his enemies. He could have asked for it, power, but he didn't. Instead of all that tempts of power, Solomon asked for wisdom. And it is not wisdom for self-gain, but it is wisdom so that he could be a better servant to his people. If you look at that reading from 1 Kings again, notice the use of the word servant. It comes up a number of times. Now, Solomon was the king, right? And it seems to me that when we think of kings, we think in a different way about a king than we would think about a servant, not necessarily putting them together. Two different jobs. We might think of a servant as someone who does the will of someone else. A servant is not in charge. A servant does not call the shots. A servant does not demand their own way. A servant does not set any policy. A servant does things at the behest of other people. The master. The servant has the lower position in this relationship, and the king, we might picture, is exalted and sitting on a magnificent throne, and you know that the king is in charge. Quite a difference in the way we look at the servant and the king. But Solomon does an amazing thing here when he brings those two positions together. He combines the majesty and the humility. He brings together the exalted and the lowly. As in verse 6, he mentions his own father, King David, to be God's servant. And then in verse 7, Solomon calls himself a servant. And then in verse 8, he says these words to God, "Your servant," himself, "your servant is here among the people." And notice that he doesn't say, "Your servant is here over the people," but he is among the people in their midst, one of the people. In verse 9, he prays, "Give your servant a discerning heart." So we see the image of the servant king in this place. We see the image of the servant king in other places in Scripture too. In Isaiah chapter 53, we hear a prophecy about a servant. Isaiah 53, we often hear that during Holy Week, and it comes to fulfillment when Jesus Christ is on the cross of his own crucifixion. The suffering servant, Jesus is called. And to quote Isaiah 53, he was despised. He was rejected. He was a man of sorrows, and he makes himself an offering for sin and made intercession for the transgressors, Isaiah 53. Making intercession for the transgressors, it says he's praying for the people that killed him. That's what Jesus did on the cross. So Jesus, who is also called the King of Kings in Revelation 17, here in Isaiah, this king is praying for you and me. Have you ever thought about that? That Jesus, one of the things he does for us is he prays for us? I don't know how that works. But God is on our side. God is pulling for us every inch of the way. The servant king is praying for you and me. Now that tells us something about Christ's servanthood. The best way that he can think of helping us every minute of every day is to pray for us. Yet Jesus is still King of Kings, right? He is God. He is above all. Yet in that highest of positions, we read in Philippians chapter 2, verse 6, that Jesus, who being the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something that should be grasped. Rather, he made himself nothing. Jesus made himself nothing, taking the very nature of the servant king. Further, we see this servant king in Luke chapter 19. the story of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. Everybody was excited. The crowds were shouting, "Hosanna, blessed is the King," right? The King who comes in the name of the Lord. Jesus, the King, did not come into town riding on some magnificent steed, but instead sat on the back of a donkey. The servant king. And in Matthew 18, when Jesus was asked about who would be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven, you know what Jesus could have said. "You're looking at him. I'm number one. I'm number one. Oh, take on the role of champion, right, Jesus?" But in humility, Jesus brought a child into their midst and said to become humble, like this little child. To be the greatest, we must be the servant. To be the greatest, Jesus became the servant of us all. Jesus is our servant king, and he said those words so that we would strive to be the same, to do the same. If Jesus Christ lives in us by faith, Jesus lives in you or me, then we would do well to pray that Christ would be reflected through us into the world through our lives of service. And as we have noted many times, the ways of the world are most often contrary to the ways of Jesus Christ. But sadly enough, we would rather have a "don't tread on me" kind of king. We would rather have a "don't mess with me" kind of king, a power kind of person, because we tend to think that power speaks to power. Worldly power often holds sway even among we who are faithful. Well, perhaps we could look at it this way. God agrees with that. Power does speak to power, God says. But as we read God's word, we see that God's power is shown in the heart of the humble servant. That's how God shows his power, over everything. Being the humble servant. The power of God is shown in the life of love and grace and forgiveness. That's the power of the kingdom of heaven. The power of God is found in peace and quiet, and the world continues to fulfill that prophecy from Isaiah 53. The world continues to despise this servant king and reject him, this suffering servant. But we who are gathered in his name want to honor him with our lives. As people of faith, we are seeking the way of the servant Christ, and we pray that God's word would come to life in us as individuals and as a family of faith gathered here, that we would rely less on the temporary glories of this world and would find our strength and our security in everything that is eternal. And those things are a gift from God. Those things are a gift from the servant king. He gives us everything we need for this temporary life. And if the days of our life are a day or 120 years, God says, "I promise you, I give you everything you need." And then he leads us into the eternal kingdom where his glory is found in the love of Jesus Christ. In a few moments, we'll be singing a hymn, a song of humble service, that we might actually If you knew the words well enough, you could sing it to the person next to you. A lot of times when we sing hymns, we sing them to God, or it tells a story of faith. But this is one that I think, it seems to me, is actually supposed to be sung to the people around you. As we stand on this earth, we look at one another as brothers and sisters in faith, and we are humbled by our own shortcomings from time to time. We don't want to be judgmental. We don't want to be careless. We don't want to hurt the people around us. We don't want to be so consumed by the things of the world around us that they take the place of all that we truly love. But there are times that we all fall short. One thing we can do is open our hearts again. It's a practice to open our hearts again to God and to open our hearts again to the people around us and ask God for greater strength than we have in this moment, to seek the strength of true love, to seek the strength of eternal love. And we open our hearts now to the people around us. In this song, we are asking the people around us this question: Will you let me be your servant? Will you let me be your servant? Let me be as Christ to you. That's the life of service: humble love, a humble service, a selfless way of serving. But that is the greater way, as God tells us over and over again in His Word. May we be inspired by the great King Solomon. He saw his greatness not in his own power, not in his own position and his abilities. Rather, he saw his greatness in being a servant of God to serve his people, a truly humble place to be. And may we be further inspired by Jesus Christ, who is our Savior, our Lord, as he is our servant King, giving up his own glory so that we could stand with him forever. May we be moved to live in love and gentle justice, seeking strength and healing in Jesus' name. And as we are in Christ, bearing his name and holding him at the center of our hearts, at the center of our minds, we accept the servant heart of the people around us too, that together we will be able to lift one another up. So our service is a blessing to all. Now we turn to hymn number 659, and we humbly ask this question to the people around us: will you let me be your servant?
When you laugh, I'll laugh with you. till we've seen this journey through. Will you let me be your servant? Let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may have the grace to let you be my servant.
We ask our ushers to wait upon us as we share our offerings. The many gifts that you have given to us. And as we share this offering, it is a portion of what you have first given to us. May it be used to your glory. May it be used to serve you, to bring the word of God to people in our communities and around the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We ask too, Heavenly Father, that you would help us to be your servant in whatever we do and however we live. We thank you for the opportunity of service to bring your word to our children as we look forward to Sunday school, but also today as we celebrate Karen's baptism. We thank you for this gift of grace that you so willingly pour out for us, the gift of life, the gift of love, the gift of forgiveness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As we go through this life, we understand that this life is temporary. We think of Leland Randall, who lived a good long life, and now at the end of his days, we celebrate his life, and we are reminded again that your promise is good forever, that you receive him as a child of God, and he looks forward, we look forward to the new life that is yet to come. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As we think too of the servants in our midst, we are grateful for those who serve in our United States military. Today, we offer a special pray for Hunter Hard as he enters the military service. We also offer in our prayers for Cody and Nick and Kara and Cole and Ashley and Thomas and Paul, your good grace and your guidance, and we pray for safety, of course. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We take a moment now to remember those who are ill or in need of your healing touch. We think of Mary and Richard, Brendan, Janice, Carmen, Shirley, Jean, Suzanne, and others that we name in our hearts at this time. We offer to the prayer that our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Teach me your way, O Lord, and I will walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart to revere your name. I will thank you, O Lord my God, with all my heart, and glorify your name forevermore. For great is your love toward me. You have delivered me from the pit of death. The arrogant rise up against me, O God, and a band of violent people seek my life. They have not set you before their eyes. But you, O Lord, are gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and full of kindness and truth. Turn to me and have mercy on me. Give your strength to your servant and save the child of your handmaid. Show me a sign of your favor so that those who hate me may see it and be put to shame, because you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me. Amen. Would you please stand as we receive the blessing? The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We go in peace now to serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our final hymn, a prayer that God would lead our way, hymn number 793, Be Thou My Vision.
Tower, raise thou me high.